Welcome all of you, and I'm very sure you people are preparing nicely for this your upcoming Cochin Shipyard exam, and this is a great opportunity for you, especially from students for South India, because you know I think the exam is in Cochin only, and only southern states students will be appearing for it. So great opportunity, proceed ahead with this. Our entire this module is on the basis of what we think question can be asked, and that is further on the basis of previous year's questions and little idea we got from our students. Now, what can be the question paper and all. Now, Cochin Shipyard, I have given you 140 question paper already. That was easy degree of difficulty. Now, I am going to give you moderate degree of difficulty. 30 question plus in this means your level is good and you can hit further, because I am covering all the subjects from here and there, and 40 questions are there. One question, 1 minute, no negative marking. We know what kind of question, degree of difficulty can be asked. But because it is, public sector papers based upon particular requirement of that public sector, so data oriented questions can also be asked. So that is what we are trying to do. We are giving you as much information as possible so that no question remains unturned, and we get a fairly good idea about the paper. So let us start it. Now I want that when I will be solving this question, I will be giving you the solution and answer also for this 40 questions. But you have to solve on your own and test your level, where your level hits. So if 30 plus you score, that means push it hard now. 27th October is the last date for filling the form of Cochin Shipyard. So fill the form and you have sufficient time to prepare, and you can push it hard and you can score well. And then 40% weightage is for interview, group discussion kind of things, where we have that is our domain, so we can really get good into that also. So I started now with my first question. So here it comes, my first question for you. Dimensions of specific entropy. Dimensions of specific entropy R, then gives you answer choices. Let me give you that: ML2 T minus 2 K minus 1, ML2 T minus 2 T minus, sorry, 1 K minus 1, then comes L2 T minus 2 K minus 1 K minus 1, and D is L2 T minus 1 K minus 1. So you can stop the video and you can tell me what is the answer for this particular question now. Okay, so whenever a question of dimension comes, like dimension of specific entropy, ask yourself which formula of entropy do you know. Heat energy is equal to TDS. So that means, now heat energy is nothing but kilojoule or joule, and that is energy. Dimension is ML2 T minus 2. The dimension of energy is ML2 T minus 2, right or not? So that is a work. Work is similar to, that is energy. Energy and work, this is a dimension. Okay. Now, what is the dimension of temperature? That is Kelvin. This is the temperature. So DS ka dimension is nothing but, what we get is ML2, then T minus 2 K minus 1. This K goes this side, and it becomes K minus 1. So ML2 T minus 2 K minus 1. But then this is entropy. Now what is specific entropy? Specific entropy is nothing but entropy per unit mass. So M gets cancelled out. It becomes L2 T minus 2 K minus 1. L2 T minus 2 K minus 1. So that is the answer for specific entropy. Hope you got it. Let's go for next question now. So next question is question number 2, which comes on your screen here. Okay, this is the question number 2 for us. Control volume has, you have to find the correct answer. Control volume, you know the meaning of this. Control volume has, find the correct answer. I give you answer choices: fixed control space, fixed or controlled space. Second choice is variable control space, variable controlled space. that is a choice number 2, and then next is stationary. Control volume is stationary, and then fixed amount of thermodynamic matter. Fixed amount of thermodynamic matter, that is the choice number 4. Okay, so these are the 4 choices given to us related to control volume. Okay, so there is a control approach, control volume approach, there is a systems approach. These are the 2 approaches we have got. What is answer? Can anybody tell me what is answer for this? Yes, this is the answer, fixed or control space. You know, control volume means you do not change the space. Let me give you an idea. This is the fluid flow through a particular duct or pipe, and I decided that okay, this is my control volume, this is my control volume. I have section 1, I have section 2, I will be analyzing the fluid flow through these 2 sections, right? So this becomes my control volume, having particular space called control surface, and particular space is there. You know, when I analyze a problem through control volume approach, which is normally done for flow problems, normally it is done for fluid flow problems, Bernoulli equation, whenever you use Bernoulli equation between 2 sections, what you are trying to do is you are trying to identify the control volume. The fluid is entering at section 1, exiting at section 2, so that is a control volume approach. In that, during the analysis, you do not change the volume, control volume. You do not change the space. If you have identified this space, it will remain like that. There is no realistic space. There is no realistic volume. You identify it for analysis. So I can make another choice also, that control volume is a realistic volume. Actually, no, it is not a real, it is a imaginary volume. I can also say this is nothing but, this is the imaginary volume. This is the imaginary space or volume which you have created for your analysis. You want to analyze it like Bernoulli equation, and all fluid flow problems are normally analyzed using this. Then there is another approach which is called systems approach. Systems approach mein there is a fixed amount of thermodynamic matter. So can you give example of systems approach? Yes, I can give you example of systems approach. So let us say piston cylinder mechanism. Let us say there is a piston cylinder mechanism in which I have kept particular matter of particular mass. mkg of matter I have kept in particular piston cylinder mechanism. Now I am increasing the pressure on this, or I am decreasing the pressure on this, matter is not changing. So in the systems approach, the volume keeps on changing, but matter remains same. In control volume, the matter keeps on entering, matter keeps on exiting, but the volume remains same. I give you another thumb rule to solve these questions. Whenever you find that in the answer choice, there are 2 contradictory statements. Now these are the 2 contradictory statements. These are contradictory statements. Whenever you find that there are 2 contradictory statements in a question, one of the statement may be answer. Because you know, either it will be this side or that side. So one of the statement has a high probability of being the answer. Having said that, read all the choices, do not blindly tick that. Okay, so answer for this was fixed or control space. Now I go to next question, question number 3. Let me go to next question. Absolute pressure of 0.5 bar means, what is the meaning of this? Let me give you answer choices. It means gauge pressure of 0.5 bar, or it means vacuum pressure of 0.5 bar, or gauge pressure of 1.5 bar. Or vacuum pressure of 1.5 bar. Here's the answer. So absolute pressure of 0.5 bar means what? Okay, so let me answer this question now. Any idea? What is absolute pressure? What is gauge pressure? You know, this is atmospheric pressure, which is at 1 bar. Now, any pressure above atmosphere is called gauge. Any pressure above atmospheric is called gauge. And any pressure below atmosphere is called vacuum pressure. Is called vacuum pressure. So, if the pressure is more than atmospheric, like in this room, pressure is atmospheric pressure, which is 1 bar. So, we assume 1 bar to be reference, and the human being stands here. This is human being on atmospheric pressure. Like I am standing at the reference, which is at 1 bar. Now, any pressure more than this is a gauge pressure for me. Any pressure less than that is a vacuum pressure for me. Absolute pressure is always measured from absolute reference. This reference is absolute reference. This is absolute reference. So, any pressure which is measured from absolute reference is called absolute pressure. Now, he has given you 0.5 bar. He has given you absolute pressure is 0.5 bar pressure. Now, this absolute pressure of 0.5 bar, if I measure from atmospheric reference, that gives me vacuum pressure also of 0.5 bar. So, answer for that will be B. This is the answer for that. Okay, done. Let's go to question number 4 now. So, I come to question number 4. Okay, now, let me write this question. Pressure temperature diagram is shown. So, he has given you a pressure temperature diagram. Find the temperature at A. Find temperature at A. And what diagram he has shown you is this. This is pressure. This is temperature. So, he has given you this diagram and is asking you to calculate temperature at this point. So, this is pressure in bar. Temperature is in degree centigrade. So, he has asked you to calculate pressure temperature diagram. What are the answer choices? -273.15 degree centigrade, -373.15 degree centigrade, 0 Kelvin. So this is the point A. Okay, now, you know, this particular is the temperature scale. So, that means it is 0 degree centigrade, positive, negative. This is, so, if you extend it on the back side, 0 Kelvin cannot be attained. But any temperature in Kelvin is 273.15 plus any temperature in degree centigrade. Right. Now, 0 Kelvin cannot be attained, that is the third law. But if we assume it to be reference, then 0 Kelvin if you assume, then C will be -273.15 degree centigrade. And in this diagram, now if you see in this diagram, what we understand is 0 degree centigrade pe pressure is not 0, but 0 Kelvin pe pressure is also 0. So, if we extend it further, though we cannot hit this place, but if you extend it further, you get -273.15 degree centigrade. So, I think the answer for this, what we can hit is -273.15 degree centigrade. 0 Kelvin, I think that is also the same thing, but because since the scale is given in degree centigrade, it is more appropriate to write it in degree centigrade. Okay, let me give you fifth question now. This comes to fifth question. Increase in pressure required, increase in pressure required to decrease unit volume ऑफ मर्क्यूरी, बल्क मॉडुलस ऑफ मर्क्यूरी इज गिवन एज 28.5 मेगापास्कल. बल्क मॉडुलस ऑफ मर्क्यूरी इज गिवन 28.5 मेगापास्कल बाय 0.1% इज हाउ मच, 285 गीगापास्कल, 285 मेगापास्कल, 2.85 मेगापास्कल, 28.5 किलोपास्कल. दीज आर द फोर चॉइसेस गिवन टू अस. रीड द क्वेश्चन केयरफुली. इंक्रीज इन प्रेशर रिक्वायर्ड टू डिक्रीज यूनिट वॉल्यूम ऑफ मर्क्यूरी वेयर द बल्क मॉडुलस इज गिवन टू अस बाय 0.1%. ओके, नाउ सिंस द क्वेश्चन इज ऑफ बल्क मॉडुलस, we know that there is a formula of bulk modulus as minus of excess pressure over volumetric strain. Now increase in pressure required to decrease unit volume of mercury, you know what is given, this is 28.5 megapascal. You should know what is the meaning of that. Mega is 10 raised to 6 pascal. Now delta p is something which we want to find out. Delta v by v is 0.1%. 0.1% means 0.1 over 100. What is 20%? 20 by 100, 1 by 5. What is 10%? 10 by 100. What is 0.1%? 0.1 by 100. So that is the meaning of it. So what is delta P? Now forget about the negative sign. I think that is delta V. P will be basically decrease the volume, so pressure will increase. 28.5 into 0.1 by 100. This is megapascal. Let's multiply it 1000 and make it kilopascal. Megapascal into 1000, kilopascal. What happens is, I think this is 10, this gets cancelled out all. It becomes 28.5 kilopascal. 28.5 kilopascal. So D is the answer for this question. 1 minute, one question, no negative marking. You should know what kind of questions, what kind of numericals can be asked. It is not going to be very bulky questions, but yes, it can be ticklish question. That brings me to question number 6 now. Let's go for question number 6. That brings me to question number 6 now. He has given you a PV diagram. He has given you a pressure volume diagram. And he has given you two paths. And he has given you two paths between two states. So state 1, state 2, path A, path B. There are two paths from state 1 to state 2. A is reversible path. A is reversible path. B is real path. A is reversible path. B is the real path. Which remains same? Which remains same for each path? Which remains same for each path? Question number, answer choice A is heat interaction. Heat interaction, work interaction, work interaction. C, energy interaction, energy interaction. D, none of these, none of these. Okay, so hit it. What do you think is the answer for this? Which of the following remains same for each path? Okay, you know, this question is based upon the, you know, path function and point function. So these 1 and 2, these are the two points. You know, there is something which is called path function and there is something which is called point function. And point function is nothing but which is thermodynamic property. Heat interaction and work interaction are the two examples which depend upon path. Heat interaction and work interaction are going to be more for reversible path, but for irreversible, which is real path, it is going to be less. Now point functions are entropy, you know, internal energy, enthalpy and total energy also. all of us know that energy is the thermodynamic property. When we say energy, it means total energy, right? So energy is a thermodynamic property and it depends upon initial and final state, not on the path followed. Hence, this question was framed on that particular concept. Good. Let's go to next question. Question number 7 now. I come to question number 7. Okay. Cylinder is filled with, so there is a cylinder which is filled with, cylinder is filled with 2 kg of oxygen and is heated at constant pressure from 27 degree centigrade to 127 degree centigrade. Heat supplied is equal to, and then he has given you some choices, which are 20 kilojoule, 201 kilojoule, 224 kilojoule, 182 kilojoule, and D is 105 kilojoule. These kind of simple questions can be expected in the exam. Okay, stop the video and try to find the answer, and keep one thing in mind that overall total time you should not take more than 40 minutes. 40 question, 40 minutes, that is a total question you should take, and you should attempt all the questions because there is no negative marking, right? Okay, now how do you calculate heat? This is mcp dt. This is a formula, right? Now what is dt given? Dt is 27 to 127, so 100 degree centigrade. Don't bother about Kelvin or centigrade because it is difference in temperature. So delta T, whether you calculate in Kelvin or you calculate in degree centigrade, is going to be same. So it is going to be 100. Now, what is mass given? Yes, mass is 2 kg. Very simple. So what is Cp? Cp cannot be put unless until you calculate it. So how do you calculate Cp? So sub Cp is gamma over gamma minus 1 into R. And what is R? Gamma over gamma minus into R universal over molecular mass. You cannot use Cp for air. That is only catch here. What is gamma for diatomic? If gas is diatomic, then gamma is 1.4. What is universal gas constant? 8314 joule per kg Kelvin. 8134 joule per kg Kelvin. What is molecular mass of oxygen? Molecular mass of oxygen is 32. This is O2, 32. So if you calculate Cp, it is going to come 0.90. This is 8.314. It can be taken as kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Right? Molecular mass is 32 kilojoule per kilomole. So what is Cp coming out to be? Cp will come out to be 0.9093, that is unit is kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Kilojoule per kg Kelvin or degree centigrade does not matter. Kilojoule per kg degree centigrade or kilojoule per kg Kelvin is same because delta T is same. The moment you put this Cp here, the answer is 182 kilojoule. I am very sure some of you have got it. And that is the answer for this. Okay, done. Now we come to question number 8. Now we come to question number 8 of this moderate degree of difficulty Cochin Shipyard paper. Okay. P raised to power gamma minus 1 over T raised to power gamma is equal to constant. P raised to power gamma minus 1 over T raised to power gamma is equal to constant, where P is pressure, absolute pressure, T is absolute temperature, and gamma is adiabatic index, which is defined as Cp over Cv. Is true for, this expression is true for, he is asking, number one, adiabatic process. Is this true for adiabatic process? Second choice, reversible adiabatic process. Reversible adiabatic process. Choice C, polytropic process. Is it true for polytropic process? D, none of these. None of these. So the question is, for which of the following processes is this expression true? P raised to power gamma minus 1 over T raised to power gamma is equal to constant is true for what? Okay, now, let me tell you from where this question came. P V raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to constant. You have heard about this, right? This expression is true for reversible adiabatic only. This is only true for reversible adiabatic. This is what we know. Now, if you put this equation in ideal gas equation, PV is equal to mRT. If you put this expression in ideal gas equation, then you know you will get different version of this. You will get different version of this. You can say PV over T is equal to constant. P over T, PV over T is equal to constant for one particular gas. So, if you use this in this, you get T raised to power gamma over P raised to power gamma minus 1 is also equal to constant. If T raised to power gamma over P raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to constant, then this particular thing can also be written as P raised to power gamma minus 1 over T raised to power gamma is equal to constant. So, there are three expressions which you get. One is PV raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to constant. PV raised to power gamma is equal to constant. Right? So, PV raised to power gamma is equal to constant. And if you put that PV raised to power gamma is equal to constant, then you get T raised to power gamma. If you put in PV raised to power gamma is equal to constant, right? And if you put that in this expression, just P ki jaga, what I do, P is equal to constant over V raised to power gamma. Just put in that. So, what you get is PV is equal to constant. P is now constant over V raised to power gamma. I put it here. Into V over T is equal to constant. See this carefully. What I did? Instead of P, I am putting constant over V raised to power gamma. Now, this becomes V raised to power 1 minus gamma over T is equal to constant. So, if you manipulate it, it becomes T into V raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to constant. If I take it this side, this particular thing becomes T into V raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to constant. Similarly, you get T raised to power gamma over P raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to constant. So, PV raised to power gamma is equal to constant. So, the same expressions we get. And hence, this particular thing is true for reversible adiabatic. So, PV raised to power gamma is equal to constant. T into V raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to constant. T raised to power gamma over P raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to constant. So, this is true. Now, had it been instead of gamma, if I put N, polytropic index, then this answer will be true for polytropic process. So, this is how it is going to be there. Okay. So, that brings me to next question now. And this is the question number 9. This is question number 9 now. Question number 9 is COP of Carnot, COP of Carnot heat pump, COP of Carnot heat pump operating between, Carnot heat pump operating between, the pump is operating between 27 degree centigrade and minus 13 degree centigrade. Is, and you have to find out what is the COP, that is 10, 5, 7.5, 2.5. So, you have to tell what is the COP of the Carnot heat pump which is operating between these two, 27 degree centigrade and minus 13 degree centigrade. Okay, now let me give you the answer for that. Carnot heat pump, and it can be Carnot refrigerator or Carnot engine also. Let us say this is Q1, this is Q2, this is W, this is T1, this is T2, and this is a reversible heat pump. You know, the COP of the heat pump actually is nothing but, so this is Q1 over W, Q1 over Q1 minus Q2, which eventually comes out to be T1 over T1 minus T2. That is the formula, we know that. Now, what is T1? 27 degree centigrade, 300 Kelvin, right? We have to write it in Kelvin. And what is the difference between the two? So it comes out to be 300 over difference between these two. So 27 minus minus 13, it comes out to be 40. If I am not wrong, that comes out to be 40. That gives me 7.5. There is a COP of Carnot heat pump. Okay, done. That brings me to question number now 10. Let me go for question number 10. Okay, done. Question number 10. COP of domestic refrigerator. COP of domestic refrigerator is lesser than, domestic refrigerator compared to domestic AC, domestic air conditioner is greater, lesser, equal, depend upon other parameters, other factors too. So we are comparing the COP of domestic refrigerator with COP of domestic air conditioner, domestic refrigerator and domestic air conditioner. So which one is COP is more or less, what do you want to say? Now let me tell you a small concept here. If I give you engine, tell me whether I am giving you refrigerator or I am giving you this is one thing and this is another thing, and you have to tell me which one is engine and which one is pump or refrigerator. This, in this case where there is a work consumption, it can be pump or it can be refrigerator, anything. Whereas this one is engine, this one is heat engine, right? This particular thing is heat engine, whereas this can be heat pump. This particular thing can be heat pump, or that is a part of refrigerator also. How do I know this is heat pump? Because heat energy is going to flow from low temperature to high temperature on the consumption of work, which is compressor work or something. And in this case, it is engine because heat energy is giving you work. Now, if you increase the temperature differences, the efficiency of the heat engine is 1 minus T2 by T1, or it can be T1 minus T2, Carnot efficiency I am giving it, T1 minus T2 by T1. So I can basically, you know, if the difference in temperature, you see this particular thing carefully. If the difference in temperature T1 and T2 is increasing, if T1 and T2 is increasing, then efficiency increases. For particular T1, if T1 minus T2 is increasing, then efficiency increases. Can you tell me what is COP of refrigerator? That is T2 over T1 minus T2. You know these formulas, right? COP of refrigerator is T2 over T1 minus T2, and COP of pump is T1 over T1 minus T2. Now, if for particular T2 which we want, minimum temperature we want, if T1 minus T2 the difference of the temperature increases, if the difference of the temperature increases, then the COP decreases. But if the difference in temperature is decreased, if T1 minus T2 decreases, then COP increases. So if delta T or T1 minus T2, if T1 minus T2, this term decreases, then COP increases. So it is like this. When I say you like this, temperature difference increases, efficiency increases. Temperature difference decreases, COP increases. Now, see the question. Domestic refrigerator operates between more temperature difference. In this case, T1 minus T2 is more compared to air conditioner. AC mein what temperature do you keep in the room? AC mein the temperature which you keep in the room is 27 degree centigrade. What is the outside temperature? 40 degree centigrade. Let's come to fridge. Domestic fridge you keep at temperature sub-zero also, 0 degree centigrade also. So, because domestic fridge works at lesser temperature difference, more temperature difference, delta T is more, hence its COP is lesser. So, COP of domestic refrigerator is less because T1 minus T2 is more, T1 minus T2 is more, that is the answer for that. Okay, let's go to question number 11 now. We come to question number 11 and I am very sure you are also checking your level. Absorption refrigeration system. Absorption refrigeration system uses the following refrigerant. Choices are R11, then it is R22, then it is CO2, then it is ammonia, Now, which one is the refrigerant in absorption refrigeration system? You know, ammonia is used as refrigerant. This is a data oriented question. It is used as refrigerant and water is used as absorbent. Water is absorbent in this. Water is absorbent and ammonia is refrigerant. You know that. Can you tell me in which system water is used as refrigerant? Have you heard about lithium bromide, you know, absorption system? In lithium bromide absorption system, water will be used as refrigerant. Water is used as refrigerant. So, I am sure you are aware about this. Okay, so let's go to next question now. That brings us to question number 12. And this is again data oriented question. What is main function of thermostatic expansion valve? What is main function of thermostatic expansion valve? Choices are to control degree of superheat. Second, to control evaporative temperature. Then to control pressure drop. And then D, to control evaporator temperature. As I told you, this is, you know, data oriented question. So, when we say that 40 question, 40 minutes, one question, no negative marking, paper is going to be pretty easy, don't be misunderstood, you know, question can be made difficult by making it data oriented. Numericals only make question paper difficult, it is not like that. Numericals only do not make question paper difficult, data can also make it difficult like this. What is thermostatic expansion valve? So, this is maintains constant degree of superheat in evaporator. The answer is this. It maintains constant degree of superheat in the evaporator. So what is the main function of thermostatic expansion valve? To maintain constant degree of superheat in the evaporator. That is the main function of thermostatic expansion valve, you should know. Okay, done. Let's hit question number 13 now. We come to question number 13. Comfort in air conditioning. Comfort in air conditioning. We always say air conditioning is comfort engineering, you know. So, comfort in air conditioning is not related to, is not related to. So, let me give you answer choices. Temperature of air or air temperature, air humidity, air purity, air pressure. Yes. So, comfort means certain things. And which one answer will you hit? Yes, we will hit air pressure. This is what the comfort engineering is. Comfort engineering is all about these three things. The air which you are supplying should have particular temperature, should have particular humidity, and then it should have particular, you know, purity. It should be pure air, you know, that is the meaning of comfort air conditioning. That is the meaning of this. Okay, let's go to next question now, 14. We hit the question number 14 now. Question number 14. Now, which of the following, which of the following has highest, which of the following has highest thermal conductivity, highest thermal conductivity? And the answer choices given are boiling water, boiling water, freezing water, steam, then ice, solid ice. Which has maximum thermal conductivity? Yes. Again, this is more or less data oriented question. So, the answer for this is solid ice. Let me give you some data. Thermal conductivity for water, let me give you, is 0.556. 0.556 watt per meter Kelvin. Right? That is for water. Now, K for steam, thermal conductivity for steam is 0.0206, same unit. And for ice, comes out to be 2.22, same unit. So, as you can see, the value of thermal conductivity for ice is far, far more than water, which is far more than steam. So, now I can say that thermal conductivity for ice is more than thermal conductivity of water, is more than thermal conductivity of steam. So, this kind of information data is helpful. So, this is a data oriented question. Okay, now next question, question number 15, Fourier law of heat conduction. Fourier law of heat conduction. Fourier law of heat conduction is given by, choice A, Q is equal to Ka dT by dx, dT by dx. Choice B, Q is minus Ka dT by dx. Choice C, q is equal to k a dx over dt, choice d, q is k a minus k a dx over dt. So these are the four choices which are given to us. Fourier law of heat conduction. Okay, now the answer for this, correct answer for this is this. Why negative sign? Negative sign, what is the meaning of that? This means heat flows from high temperature, high to low temperature. Heat flows from high temperature to low temperature. There is a meaning of negative sign, right? This is how it is there. Okay, next question, question number 16. Again, this is more or less data oriented question. So I hit question number 16 now, and that question is also data oriented question. And the question is minimum number of piston rings in internal combustion engine are choice A 1, 2, 3, 4. Minimum number of piston rings in internal combustion engine. Okay, the answer for this is 3. So normally, you know, piston rings are made up of, you know, सेल्फ लुब्रिकेटिंग होती हैं, वो तो कास्ट आयरन की बनी होती हैं, एंड दीज आर यूज टू प्रिवेंट द लीकेज एंड यू नो वियर एंड टीयर ऑफ द पिस्टन, बिकॉज पिस्टन इज कॉस्टलियर आइटम, सो दीज प्रिवेंट द वियर एंड टीयर डायरेक्टली ऑफ द पिस्टन एंड मेंटेन द यू नो दिस लीक प्रूफ सिस्टम एंड ऑल्सो सेल्फ लुब्रिकेटिंग होती हैं ये. सो दिस रेंज इज फ्रॉम 3 to 6 कास्ट आयरन पिस्टन्स ring. Cast iron is not made up of this piston is not made up of cast iron. Piston is made up of some conductive material, but cast rings are made up of cast iron, and these you know, for self lubricating benefit which we get, and they have got good resilience also. Next question, question number 17. That brings me to question number 17. Car has 3 cylinders. There is a car which has 3 cylinders. Car has 3 cylinders with the total displacement of the car is 770 cubic centimeter. Compression ratio is 8.7. Compression ratio is 8.7. What is clearance volume of each cylinder? That is a question, and the answer choices given are 34.4 cubic centimeter, then 33.3 cubic centimeter, then 32.3 cubic centimeter, and then 35.2 cubic centimeter. So clearance volume is asked. So stop the video and try to find out what is the, okay, so let me tell you now. Compression ratio is nothing but total volume over clearance volume, and total volume mein there is a swept volume plus clearance volume over clearance volume, and the swept volume is nothing but this total displacement volume. This swept volume is a displacement volume only, swept or displacement volume, swept volume or displacement volume, that is how it is. Now compression ratio is given as 8.7, and clearance volume, this total, this particular thing is also given to us. So I think this swept volume, we this is nothing but Vs over Vc is 7.7. If you break it, Vs over Vc will be coming like this. And what is the V clearance now? Swept volume is given to us. So, V clearance is 770 over 7.7. That comes out to be 100 cubic centimeter. Right? That comes out to be 100 cubic center, the cubic centimeter. So, that is for 3 cylinders. So, for one cylinder, this comes out to be 33.3. So, there are 3 cylinders. Total clearance volume for 3 cylinders is this. Right. So, when we say 800 cc, Maruti 800, 800 cubic centimeter. So, that means all the 3 cylinders collectively are 800 cc. So, one cylinder, how much you can calculate that also. So, that question was based upon that. Let's go for next question now. That question is question number 18. Okay. Now, octane number for natural gas. Octane number for natural gas is, answer choices are 60 to 80, 80 to 100, greater than 100, and less than 60. You know, octane number is calculated for SI fuels, petrols, and cetane number is calculated for CI fuels, that is diesels. So, octane number for petrol, natural gas, natural gas is even better than petrol in combustion behavior. This octane number and all, they are based upon the combustion behavior, combustion phenomena. So, petrol, when you are using in SI engine, its combustion phenomena should be good. It should lead to good combustion without any kind of, any kind of knocking or detonation. So, natural gas is even better than petrol for combustion. No knocking, no detonation. So, it is this number, octane number, sorry, is greater than 100, because natural gas has better combustion behavior than petrol. So, petrol typically has 100 isooctane ka octane number, which is typically petrol, is 100. Natural gas is even better. When we say better, that means minimum detonation. Abnormal behavior is not there, abnormal combustion is not there, and the detonation and knocking phenomena that is there. Okay, now similar question, 19 number question. Cetane number of automotive diesel, automotive diesel fuel used in India is in the range of 30 to 40, 41 to 50, 51 to 60, 61 to 70. Cetane number of automotive diesel fuel used in India is in what range? Again, totally data oriented question. There is no logic use, there is no logic required. These are data. So, the diesel which we use in India, uska cetane number is typical for compression ignition fuels, CI fuels ke liye hum cetane number nikalte hain, aur uska aapka jo cetane number hai, that is 40 to 50, 41 to 50, that is the meaning of it. Okay, so let's go to next question now, question number 20. As I told you, that question paper can be made difficult if you make it more data wise, data oriented. Common rail injection system common rail injection system uses the injection pressure of the order of, so what is the pressure it is creating? 100 to 200 bar, then 200 to 400 bar, then 400 to 600 bar, and then 1500 bar. What is answer? You know where is injection system used? It is in the used in diesel fuels, because the fuel is to be injected in diesel vehicles. So what is the injection pressure which is we are going to use in common rail injection system? Again, this is a data oriented question, so we will go for 1500 bar. There is very high pressure which is used. You should have some idea about what is the injection which we are using. I think that is a, this question was based upon that. Let me hit next question now. So question number 21. Okay. Depth of center of pressure, depth of center of pressure of rectangular lamina. Lamina is nothing but plate immersed vertically. In water up to height h is, so what will be the, let's use this space also, so what will be the depth of center of pressure of rectangular lamina which is immersed vertically in water? So what will the height is given you h by 2, then gives h by 3, h by 4, 2 by 3 h. These are the four choices given to us. Now, so suppose I give you this fluid and this is a rectangular lamina, you know, and this is the centroid or center of gravity. We know this is nothing but h bar, and hydrostatic pressure force is acting, entire hydrostatic pressure force is going to act at a point which is called center of pressure P. Now the distance of center of pressure from the free surface is to be measured. That is what he is saying. And what is the formula? Let me give you another view of this. Let us say now the rectangular plate is having width B and height is H. This is the front view of that, right? So what is the formula of H star? H star is H bar plus something, and that something is Ig over Ah bar if it is not inclined plate, right? For vertical plate. What is Ig? Ig is the moment of inertia of this plate about this axis. And what is this Ig? This is equal to Bh cube by 12. Bh cube by 12. And what is H bar? H bar is H by 2. So if you put all the formulas, this will come out to be 2 by 3 H. That everyone of you knows. So all of you were aware about this. So I am very sure you were knowing this particular part. Okay. So let's go for next question now. This comes to question number 20 now. Second. Yeah. That is a question number 22nd for us now. Okay. Pressure drop for viscous flow. Pressure drop for viscous flow in pipe of diameter 600 millimeter and length 30 meter is 70 kilopascal. What is wall shear stress? So So what will be wall shear stress? And the answer choices are 0 Pascal, then 1400 Pascal, then 700 Pascal, and then it is 350 Pascal. So these are the answer choices. Okay, so I believe you know this particular formula. Maybe you know this particular formula. Wall shear stress is dP by dx into r by 2. Maybe you know this formula. And I am not going to tell you from where this formula came. I think you already know it. Or maybe you can watch the marathon fluid mechanics video. It is mentioned there. dP by dx is nothing but pressure gradient, you know, along the length. And this pressure gradient along the length is because of energy loss, viscous energy loss, because we are given the viscous fluid. So this is dP by dx. Now, what is dP by dx given? This is 70 kilopascal. It is given pressure drop is 70 kilopascal. So I make it this much Pascal. What is R given? Diameter is 0.3 meter divided by 2. And then tau comes out to be 350 Pascal. 350 Pascal. This is answer. D is the answer for this particular question. Right. Let's go to next question now. Question number 23. Okay, done. Turbulent shear stress is due to what? Viscosity of fluid. Viscosity of fluid. Okay, then velocity fluctuation. Velocity fluctuation along longitudinal direction. Longitudinal direction. Velocity fluctuation. Along transverse direction. Transverse direction. And answer D is both B and C. So velocity fluctuation in longitudinal also and velocity fluctuation in transverse direction also. Okay, done. So what answer would you hit for this? Okay, the answer for this is both velocity fluctuation in. So answer is both B and C. Velocity fluctuation in longitudinal direction also and in transverse direction also. So the answer for this is both in longitudinal as well as transverse direction. So we come to now question number 24. Here we come question number 24. Okay, so now the question number 24 is related to hydraulic mean radius, hydraulic mean depth. Hydraulic mean depth for circular plate, for circular pipe, sorry, of dia of diameter D is, and the answer choices also is given you. This is D, D by 2, D by 4, D by 3. What is hydraulic mean depth for circular pipe of diameter D? Let me first define what is hydraulic mean depth. This is the definition. Hydraulic mean depth is defined as, you know, this is area over perimeter. Area over perimeter. Area over perimeter. So that is nothing but pi d square by 4 over pi d, that comes out to be d by 4, right? So this is the answer for hydraulic mean depth. So many you know, civil engineers are using this concept in they're finding the hydraulic mean depth and everything. So that is the open channel flow, river flow and all, this question comes there. So let's go to now, I think question number 25. We come to question number 25. Let's try to solve this question. is given, this question is related to turbulent boundary layer. So velocity distribution, velocity distribution in the turbulent, velocity distribution in the turbulent boundary layer, turbulent boundary layer is, so he has given you velocity distribution as y over delta raised to power 1/7. So u over v is equal to y over delta raised to power 1/7. So in this, you know, this u is the velocity at particular y distance and v is the free stream velocity. What is displacement thickness? What is displacement thickness? So what is the displacement thickness? That is a question, and the answers given are delta, then second is delta by 7, then 7/8 delta, and then delta by 8. So these are the you know, answer choices given. What is displacement thickness? You know, there are three kind of thicknesses: displacement thickness, momentum thickness, energy thickness. So displacement thickness, momentum thickness, energy thickness, these are actually the terms which cater to the losses in, you know, flow rate, in the momentum, in the energy. Once a boundary layer is formed, there is always some kind of loss of you know, flow rate, which is measured by displacement thickness, loss of momentum, which is calculated by momentum thickness, and loss of energy, which is calculated by energy thickness. So let me give you the formula for displacement thickness. I think you know, delta star is 1 minus u over v, and raise this dy, integration 0 to delta. What is delta? This is the boundary layer thickness, and u and v you already know. So if I put this value, it comes out to be y by delta raised to power 1/7 and dy 0 to delta. So if you open it up, you get, you know, this y 0 to delta minus, you know, 1/7 plus 1 over 1/7 plus 1 into delta raised to power 1/7, that also 0 to delta. You know the integration, that already known to you. If you solve this question, you know, you are going to get delta by 8. Delta by 8, that is going to be the answer for that. So velocity distribution in turbulent boundary layer was given to us, and this is what we can calculate. So boundary, this displacement thickness, momentum thickness, energy thickness, and as I told you, we are making this entire thing on the basis of what probable questions can be asked. So on the basis of that, we are making it. So we can calculate it like that. Now we come to question number 26. Okay, ratio of maximum shear stress to maximum normal stress, maximum shear stress to maximum normal stress at any point in a solid solid circular shaft subjected to torsion is, the answer choices are 1, 1.5, 2, none of these. So these are the four choices which are given to us. Okay, so what can be the answer for this is, let me now give you the type of loading. So torque applied, you know, this is the pure shear loading case. If I ask you that there is a shaft subjected to pure torque, and make the you know, Mohr circle for this loading, this is what you are going to make. I mean, this is the origin of this Mohr circle, and center of Mohr circle will coincide. So this is the sigma 1, and this is the tau max, So, as you can see, the shear stress, maximum shear stress and maximum normal stress, which is the principal stress, the values of both these are going to be equal. The values are equal, and that is equal to radius of Mohr circle. So, answer for that is 1. Ratio of maximum shear stress to maximum normal stress at any point in solid circular shaft is going to be this. Okay. Now, we come to question number 27. That brings us to question number 27. Strain energy stored in solid circular shaft, is proportional to, and he has given you answer choices, GJ, 1 by GJ whole square and GJ whole square. These are the four choices. So, strain energy stored in solid circular shaft is proportional to what? That is the question which is given to us. Now, what is the answer for that? You know this equation, this strain energy is half of torque into theta. And if you make analogy, then strain energy is half of force into deflection. You know, if you go for linear loading, that means if you go for longitudinal loading, a particular bar subjected to force F, deformation is delta X, then this is how you can go for it. And then similar to that, half of torque into theta, that is how it will come up. Now, what is T over J is equal to G theta over L. That is a torsion equation. So, I can represent theta as T L over G J. So, if you put that value here, U comes out to be T square L over 2 G J. So, it comes out to be proportional to 1 by G J. That is the answer for that. Now, let's come to question number 28. So, let us solve now question number 28. Okay, now this is what he has given us. Let us see what is the meaning of this. He has given us this question now. Okay, now this is what? This is a cross section. He says that cross section, this one is cross section of beam subjected to, cross section of beam subjected to shear force is given. So, this is the cross section of the beam subjected to shear force, right? Shear stress distribution. Now, shear stress distribution for this section along depth is, up you have to tell what is the shear stress distribution along the depth of this particular section which is given, and he has given you some diagrams. First diagram he gives you this, second diagram he gives you is this, you know, third diagram he gives you is this. And last diagram he has given you is this, right? Now, what is the answer for that? You know, this is again, you should have done it. The only difference between A and B is towards the center also, it is increasing, you know, it increases. And why there is a sudden drop? Because there is a sudden increase in the width of this section, sudden increase in the width. You know, whenever there is a beam or a shaft which is subjected to some kind of shear force, then there are different kind of stresses which are induced. You know that there are normal stresses, there are shear stresses, bending stresses which are normal stresses, and the shear stresses which are complementary in nature. So, there are two kind of shear stresses which are induced in the beams. On the transverse section, there is a average shear stress, and then there is a horizontal shear stresses. which are basically function of y. I mean, they depend upon how far you are calculating from the neutral axis. So towards the neutral axis and then away from the neutral axis, at the top and bottom fiber it is 0, but this is the basically diagram for that. Let's go for next question. So we hit question number 29. Okay, so now let's go question number 29. A cantilever of span 4 meter carries a point load at free end. If the slope is 2 degree, that means 0.035 radian, the deflection at free end would be, answer choices are 84.3 millimeter, 93.3 millimeter, 101.3 millimeter, and 98.3 millimeter. So cantilever of span 4 meter carries point load at the free end. Now let me give you the formulas. All of us are aware. So if I give you a cantilever of flexural rigidity EI, length let's say L, and subjected to W, the load, then you know it will have some kind of deflection delta, and there will be slope theta, deflection and slope, right? So what is the formula of deflection? WL cube over 3EI, and what is the slope? WL square over 2EI. These formulas you already remember. W is the point load, L is the length. So if you see the relation between these two, so deflection will be equal to slope into 2L by 3. Slope into 2L by 3 is the deflection. So we are given the, total length as 4 meter and slope is to be put in radian. So if degree is given, you have to put it in radian. So if you do that, I think the answer will be 93.3 millimeter. That is the deflection which we are going to get. Okay, so that brings us to next question, which is question number 30. Now he has given this as PE as Euler load, PC as crushing load, and PR as Rankine load, So these are the three terms given. PR will be, so you are to tell which among them is the correct expression for PR. So that is PE plus PC, PE minus PC, PE PC under root, and PE PC over PE plus PC. So which one is the correct answer for this? Very simple question. Okay, so all of you know that if we are given the Euler load and we are given the crushing load, then Rankine load can be calculated like this formula, and which gives us PR as this. Now Euler load is for long columns, slenderness ratio should be high. P crushing is for the short columns. But when I go to PR, all lengths can be covered. That is the most important thing. So Rankine thought of innovative thing, and then he said, okay, use my formula. It can be used for short columns, it can be used for long columns, it can be used for columns of all lengths. That is what actually was Rankine formula. Now we come to next question, which is 31. That brings us to question number 31. If closed coil, helical spring absorbs, absorbs 60 newton millimeter of energy by extending 10 millimeter its stiffness, its stiffness will be, its stiffness will be, so answer choices are given 12 newton per millimeter, then 1.2 newton per millimeter, then 16 newton per millimeter, and then 120 newton per millimeter, right. So if this is given to us, closed coil helical spring, and this is the energy and this is the extension, what will the stiffness? Okay, now let me give you the formula for spring energy. It is half of k x square. So what is k? 2u by x square. I think that is what we want to find. Now what is u? 60 newton millimeter. And what is you know, this extension x, which is 10 millimeter. So if you put all the things in value, you will get k in newton per millimeter. If you put all the things in value, I think it comes out to be 1.2 newton per millimeter. So very straight question, very straight formula, right? Okay, so let's go to next. Now next question, the question number 32. Question number 32 now. Okay, this is, he has given you a mechanism, a linkages. So one is fixed, then 2, then 3, then 4, then 5. So this is, okay, so now this is given, find degree of freedom for 5 links, planar mechanism, planar linkages, linkage, let us say, call it, having five revolute pairs. So there are 5 pairs which are revolute pairs, and you have to find out the degree of freedom. And answer choices are also given. Answer choices are 1, 2, 3, 4. So what are the degrees of freedom for this revolute pair, this revolute linkages, right? So what is the formula? You should know what is the formula of degree of freedom. This comes out to be 3n minus 1 minus 2p. So what is the n? That is 5. And how many lower, higher, you see, this is the lower pairs. So how many lower pairs we have? These are 5 lower pairs or revolute pairs, so junctions. This is the pair number 1, junction 1, junction 2, junction 3, junction 4, junction 5. And how many links are there? N1, N2, N3, N4, N5. So 5 links and 5 pairs, right? Put the formula and you get number of degrees of freedom as 2. I am sure you people are aware about this. Okay, done. Now we come to question number 33. That brings us to question number 33. A slider is sliding at 10 centimeter per second. So that is a speed on a link rotating at, there is a link which is rotating at 60 rpm. Find the Coriolis acceleration, and he has given you answer choices as 40 pi square centimeter per second square. Then this is 4 pi square centimeter per second square. Then 40 pi centimeter per second square. Then 4 pi centimeter per second square. So you have to find out the Coriolis acceleration. What will be the Coriolis acceleration? And you know the formula of Coriolis acceleration. So let me give you, if there is a link which is rotating at omega radian per second, and there is another link which is moving at velocity v on this particular link, if it is moving at velocity v on this particular link, then what is Coriolis acceleration? Coriolis acceleration is 2 times omega v, but omega is should be in radian per second. So you know this is 2 pi n by 60. What is n? 60 rpm. So this comes out to be 2 pi radian per second, and then you know v is also given to you. So if you put that particular in formula, you get 40 pi. C is the correct answer here. C is the correct answer. Now let's go for next question, and next question brings us to question number 34. There is a question number 34 here. Meter gears are, what are the meter gears? These are having different modules, meter gears are having different modules. Second, having double helical gears, then spur gears of equal dia and pitch, then right angled bevel gears having same number of teeth. Okay, so these are the four choices which are given to us. So you need to see which choice you want to hit for bevel gears. As I told you, you know, paper can be made difficult without introducing long numericals. It can be difficult, you know, without introducing long numerical, because it can be data oriented. So meter gear, if you don't know that, you cannot solve this question. That is a data information. You need to know that particular thing here. Let's hit question number 35 now. Sensitivity of governor. So this is not governor of state or chief minister and governor, that thing we are not talking about. So what is the sensitivity of governor as a, you know, device? It is defined as range of speed divided by mean speed, that is 1 mean speed divided by range of speed, that is number 2. Number 3, mean speed into range of speed, then D, none of these. So these are the four choices which are given to us. So again, this is more or less data oriented question. So mean speed divided by range of speed is the answer for this particular question. Mean speed over range of speed is the answer for this particular question. Okay, so let's come to now question number 36. So we hit question number 36 here now. Okay, now which of the following regions of electromagnetic spectrum would be used to determine structure of crystalline solid. Microwave, then gamma, then sorry, microwave, then X-ray, then ultraviolet, and then visible. So, you know, electromagnetic spectrum, depending upon the frequency and wavelength, there is a very wide spectrum, and you have visible also, which we call Vibgyor. Visible is called Vibgyor. So the question is, crystallography, which of the region is used for crystallography? And this question is on the basis of the common sense. You know, you must have heard about XRD, X-ray diffraction. XRD means X-ray diffraction. Almost all good institutes have XRD machine, along with the scanning electron microscope and TEM, right? So these are the two, these are the devices which are used to analyze the structures, right? Microstructures. Crystallography mein you study microstructure. So XRD is the technique, X-ray diffraction is the technique which you use to study the microstructure. So that question was based upon that. Okay, let me give you next question now, question number 37. Perlite is combination of, so he has given you answer choices, ferrite and cementite, then cement and gamma, then comes ferrite and austenite, then comes ferrite and gamma. So these are the four categories which are given to us. You see, perlite is typically steel structure. You know, 0.8% where you get eutectic point, you know, hyper and hypo eutectoid. So 0.8% where you get eutectoid point, and perlite is formed there. So perlite is made up of ferrite and cementite. Cementite is a hard structure, Fe3C, and ferrite is sort of alpha, that is a, you know, soft iron. So soft plus hard milke perlite banate hain, and perlite is the steel which occurs at eutectoid point, and there is a typical, you know, heat treatment processes related to this. So that is how this all goes. Now we come to question number 38. Spherodizing is done. Why do we do? To improve what? Spherodizing is done to improve what? Hardness, strength, machinability, or toughness. These are the four answer choices are given, right? So what should be the answer to this? Spherodizing, you know, there are heat treatment processes. We have heat treatment processes. In the heat treatment process, we have normalizing. Normalizing provides the, you know, strength and hardness to the workpiece. But then quenching is done in this particular process. Normalizing, that is very fast cooling is to be done, and natural formation of that quenching is martensite, which is very hard. Martensite is very hard. Now you need to reduce the hardness and tempering is done after normalizing. Tempering to reduce the hardness. So which increase the hardness? Normalizing increase the hardness. Our purpose is not to increase hardness, but you know, every process which increase the strength eventually also increase the hardness. We don't want to increase the hardness. And then first we increase the strength and hardness both, and then we reduce that hardness by tempering process. Annealing, on the other hand, is a broad term. It can be used for stress relieving, or it can be used for, you know, grain restructuring so that ductility could be promoted or increased. As far as this spherodizing is concerned, the name suggests that the grain size, the name suggests that the grain size will increase and machinability will be increasing. So spheroidizing eventually increases the size of the grain and machinability will be increased. So this is spheroidizing process. Now we go to, you know, question number 39. Question number 39. And that question is, what is swaging? Swaging is, so he has given you some choices and you have to tell what is swaging. Choice A, reducing the cross section of rod, by repeated blows. That is number one. Number two, increasing the cross section. By repeated blows. Third, bending of the rods. And D, stretching of rod. So these are the four choices given related to swaging, reducing the cross section of the rod by repeated blows. And again, unless until you have the knowledge, you cannot answer it. So here is the rod and I do hammering on this rod, right? So the purpose of hammering is, like, I want to reduce the cross section. This process is called swaging process. So this particular process is called swaging process. Okay, so now I come to question number 40. Which of the following is the welding process to be used for aluminium? कौन सी प्रोसेस हम एल्यूमिनियम के लिए यूज करेंगे? विच प्रोसेस? आर्क वेल्डिंग, गैस वेल्डिंग, टिग वेल्डिंग, और योर मिग वेल्डिंग? ओके, okay, so what is the answer for this? TIG welding. You know, when you weld aluminium, at high temperature, aluminium makes aluminium oxide, which is a very, very hard ceramic. You know, this aluminium oxide is used in the grinding wheel basically to cut the metal. So very, very hard material, aluminium oxide. It is a ceramic actually. The melting point of aluminium is low, but melting point of aluminium oxide is very high. That is the reason if aluminium oxide is formed, then welding, further welding will be a trouble. What we do then? So what we do is we try to, you know, prevent the aluminium getting oxidized. We try to prevent that. And for that you need to provide the atmosphere without oxygen for welding of aluminium. Now in arc welding and gas welding we have oxygen, but in tungsten inert gas, why inert gas is supplied? So inert gas is supplied, why? Because there should not be any contact of, you know, aluminium with oxygen. So inert gas is supplied. In MIG also inert gas is also supplied, but in the MIG you supply the additional, you know, filler rods also. That is for high metal deposition, which is not the requirement in aluminium. So TIG welding is the actual answer. So all the problems related to welding of aluminium are, you must have seen that aluminium is not welded normally. So all the problems are associated with the formation of aluminium oxide, which leads to the problem of its welding. Hope you have done these questions, and if you have 30 plus, you are scoring 30 plus in this test, your level is good. Prepare really nicely. Cochin Shipyard is a great opportunity. Why? Because they are going to call many students for interview stage, because 40% weightage is for interview and group discussion, which we can obviously prepare very nicely. So proceed ahead and prepare well for that. Thank you.